show them the ways that they can actually do that without necessarily going there in person, perhaps, but other means. And I think
you raise a really interesting point there, and I just want to remind people who are just switching on the radio from all around the world, this is a special edition of World Have You Say. We're live from the Hopscotch Asian Women's Centre in London, and we're talking to a group of Muslim women and also some men as well about these proposals by the Met, by the police to get British Muslim women involved in stopping relatives, friends from going to Syria and being involved in fighting. Around 400 people have gone to Syria so far. Around 20 have been killed. Around 40 have been held for Syrian-related offences. I wonder, Selina, when you're talking about telling people what it is like in Syria, what do you think the attraction is for young men particularly to go to Syria? I'm not talking about aid convoys. I'm talking about those people who want to go and fight. What's the appeal?
I think as a young person, people tend to be looking for a purpose and a sense of belonging, and they're looking for a cause. And the sad thing is that if Muslim men have been bashed for the last 12 years since 9/11, there's been nothing but Muslim men bashing in the media. And there isn't a sense of purpose or a sense of belonging amongst many of our Muslim young men. And I think that's what we're seeing. We're seeing the result of our treatment of those young men. And we have to take collective responsibility and actually look at what we can do to bring them back in and give them that sense of belonging within our communities. And that requires a whole community approach. That's not just for the mothers or the sisters of these young men to do. And that collective responsibility lies with all of us.
Chloe, it's Davis here again.
So what you're saying
if you'll allow, many of the things that have been said are open to interpretation and debates, and I would be readily happy to do so. But let's just set the terms of the basic problem very clearly in this question of terrorism and what happens to the people that go out there. The academic research is absolutely crystal clear. Two-thirds of the people that are going to Syria are joining fighters such as ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra. These are clearly al-Qaeda aligned. They are not helping the Syrian president. I've personally spoken to the president of the SNC many times, and these are the people that are killing the Syrian civilians. So let's not pretend that there isn't a problem there. And the second part of the research is very clear that in past conflicts, 1 in 9 people that has been to such a trip comes back and is involved in offences on terrorism. This is about terrorism, and what it is about is about the vast innocent majority being offered a way because they do not want this for their children. No sane person wants this for their children. They're devastated by this, and they want to know, what can I do about this? Now, I'm open to the debate about how exactly to go about it, as some of your guests are saying. I'm not open to the debate of dragging this onto some other territory, definitionally, over crimes of war and whatever else. This is about helping the Muslim community. It is about empowering the women in the Muslim community who have been clearly and legitimately identified as the carriers of first order, who are able to spot these kinds of things.
Can I also ask a question in terms of, do you feel it's a societal responsibility as opposed to just a particular segment?
Forgive me, we've heard that many times again. What does that
mean? But you haven't really answered it.
What does that mean in practice? Of course we have societal responsibilities, but right now what's happening is innocent Muslim children of families who do not want their kids to be radicalized and go out and do this are going abroad, and they're finding out about it when the kid is dead. How long is it going to take until you can at least recognize that the police offering them an avenue to try and do something about that if they spot a sign early is a good thing? And then we can debate how that avenue should look.
So I'm not debating against what you're saying here. I think the frustration lies in terms of your argument, because people then feel that the whole onus of this is your problem, can you solve it, doesn't really help in terms of that togetherness of what we need to do as well.
If your child in the United Kingdom in 2014 is being radicalized to join Al-Qaeda, it is a problem, and it needs to be sorted out in that way.
Davis, but you're dealing in black and whites only.
Not by all of us. By all of us in principle, but in practice, if you are the parent watching this development, you need a practical avenue. You don't need people who are in helping people get benefits or employment or education telling you on the radio that it's a societal problem. You need a number to call that you can work this out with. And I'm happy to have the debate about who is at the end of that number.
Sorry,
and how
Davis,
I agree.
I'm not sure where you're going with that.
Hang on. I have to say, Davis, as you've criticised the two ladies sitting opposite me, I think it's only fair that they can respond. Issue you first and then you, Rosemary.
I'm sorry, Davis, but how can you say it's an individual matter? Because even issues like, for example, forced marriage, when it's really to deal with individual, the government is getting involved and there's different agencies and bodies are getting together to resolve the problem. How could you say it's only the responsibility of a mother or a family
I'm not saying that it's only the responsibility of the mother
and family. But that's what you were implying.
I wasn't. I was not implying that. I was saying that if
But then
you're
your
going,
message wasn't heard.
If you're going to come and say that this is a societal issue, I will say of course
it is. If it's a matter of terrorism, then it's the society.
You and me agree, but at the same time, the police program is one small slice, and we can debate about how well executed a slice of offering an avenue in society to the people that are being harmed by this, those kids that are being radicalized and joining Al-Qaeda in Syria, to be able to have the people around them intervene. That is a very specific, very practical element of a societal issue of which we could discuss many facets.
But you're saying that it's the central role of the women to do that.
No, I'm not, and neither is the police.
You said it was central.
No, I am not.
The women are central, you
said. I am not, and neither is the police. What I am saying is that women are very often agents of change, and that women are central to the family, and that therefore it is the case that often they might be in a position where they see these kinds of developments first. I'm not saying that they are the only ones, but again, I just cannot understand. I agree with you, by the way. I would have much preferred for my female colleague to be making these arguments, as she did early on across the media. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to, but somebody has to stop this idea that this is a nefarious program on the part of the British state to incriminate Muslim kids. This is a program to help the Muslim community.
I think you misunderstood. I think what I was trying to imply, and I think the others are also trying to imply, is the fact that the solution comes having all of us involved rather than pointing the finger at one community, which you tend to keep implying.
Well, look, you know, Davis, just 1 second. Davis, you've had
to be saying that. Davis, I am not implying that.
Hang on, if we all talk over the top of each other, people around the world screaming at each other,
I am not implying that. I want to be very clear. I am not implying that. What I am implying is there is a societal issue. This is not what we're discussing here. What we're discussing is a very specific issue and an avenue, a sensible avenue, and we can discuss the calibration of that avenue. But a sensible avenue that has been offered to these people to address that specific facet. Nobody is saying that it is Muslim mothers who are responsible for this. What they are saying is that there needs to be an avenue for Muslim mothers that are concerned about this. And there are people in the paper whose kids
but
have died.
There's other nationalities, there's other races of mothers that's equally concerned.
But they are not going to Syria to join Al-Qaeda right now.
Listen, Davis is dealing in black and white only. Okay? There is a reality here, which is that, I agree with Davis on the side, that families are devastated when they lose their children. Any family would.
Yes,
you know,
of course.
Have children of my own, I'd be devastated if they lost their lives in that way. But at the same time, I've met a number of the families who have lost their children. And I can guarantee you one thing, that nearly all of the families that I met were damn proud of their kids. They said it's horrible, and it was horrible that they lost their children in that way.
Who were these children fighting for when they were in Syria?
They weren't fighting for ISIS or Jabhat, okay?
So who were they fighting with?
With the rebel forces. With the main rebel forces.
What are the main rebel forces?
Like Afrar, for example.
Like Afrar.
For example, Davis, you've had your moment. Just 1 second. People like Davis
I'm actually going to jump in at this point. Zubaydah, you've done really well actually in doing my job, so I appreciate you trying to bring everybody back to the issue. Maybe you should sit here rather than me. We've literally got about 4 minutes of the programme left, and I just want to bring in another guest who's been listening very patiently to everything you've been saying. Misrat Zia is General Secretary of the Muslim Women's Network UK. Misrat, thank you for joining us, and thank you for being so patient. What would you like to say?
I think what I'd like to say is that in principle we do support this campaign because I do think that it is necessary. What I do want more clarification on, and I think many people would agree, is how this is going to be made to work and what assurances are going to be offered to those mothers who are then willing to do something to prevent their young men going off to fight. I think there is a huge issue in terms of education. I don't think young people, Muslim young people, know enough about the principles of things like jihad to be able to make informed decisions. And this is a failing on the part of maybe Muslim leadership and society in general, because why are these young people so disengaged, so disenfranchised that they have to go and find something overseas when there is so much to be able to do for them to be able to do here at home? And I do agree, it's a strand, but it should be one of many rather than just be used as a tool to maybe stigmatise and to beat one particular community.
Well, you've all gone quiet on me now.
Because one of the earlier speakers, she talked about partnerships with other agencies, and I think that is actually quite key, because we're sort of living in we're living in a generation, we've got a whole generation of young people that are unemployed, disengaged, not in any form of training. They just cannot see any kind of future. So when you're sort of at a low ebb, when your morale's low, sometimes you can sort of look at other things that is actually giving you, I suppose, what you call a sense of belonging.
Do you think that's the appeal of going to Syria for some young people?
I strongly believe that a lot of the people that does go to Syria, they're going for humanitarian issues. I think once they get there, the environment, the climate, the landscape is completely different to what they expect. And obviously, you know, there may be things that are influencing how they see things. They're probably seeing a snapshot of things and they're making a decision what they feel that they should be doing, which is right or whatever it's right or wrong. But if we're looking at getting the community more involved in terms of women, we need to actually get the partnership agencies involved so that women can actually help and support.
It's almost like you're saying that actually, rather than getting the women to go directly to the police and talk to them, maybe if there could be some interim agencies so that then they don't feel that the police could come knocking on the door, stigmatise the family, arrest the son, but at least the warning signs are there. Listen, thank you all so much for today's discussion. It's been very, very interesting, and thank you for your hospitality here. Rosemary, it's been very good of you to put us up at incredibly late notice. If you want to carry on talking about this, head to facebook.com/worldhaveyoursay. You can tweet using the hashtag WHYS, and I'll speak to you again very soon. Thanks for listening. Keep on dropping.